Would you stand with us this morning as we begin to give praise, all hail, the power of Jesus' name.
Here for worship, even if you were intending to come to Bible study and you missed your alarm moving forward. We're glad you're here this morning. What a glorious day it is to be here to worship our risen Lord and Savior. If you are visiting for the first time today and you set your alarm, you're here and you there is a yellow card in the pew in front of you. We would love to have you fill that out, or in the bulletin there's a QR code you can scan and fill that out digitally. Please put it in the offering plate as it's passed, or you can take it down in front of our nursery. There is a welcome desk, and we have a special gift to give you if you are a first-time visitor. Kids, come on up. It is time for children's time. All right, I have something in this bag this morning that I think most of you like. It's not Legos. It is colorful, maybe. Dum-dums. Do y'all like dum-dums? Oh, I love dum-dums. They're so good. They are so good. Okay, so do y'all have a favorite flavor? A surprise? Oh, you like the mystery one? You like that, really? You like to not know? Okay, well, let me tell you what the flavors are. The flavors are strawberry, orange, blueberry, green apple, grape, watermelon, and there's a brown one in there. Do y'all know what that brown one is? It's not root beer. It's not. It's not. I promise it's not. Don't watch me. It is. What is it, Andrew? Butterscotch. That's right. Did you know that that is the one that gets looked over? I didn't mean to throw that. I really didn't. Can I have it? That's the one that gets left behind the most. And I don't know if it's because these other ones are colorful and bright, and butterscotch is just kind of brown and bleh looking. I'm glad you like it. Okay, awesome. So, and that's a good point, right? Not everybody likes the same thing. Everybody likes different things. But what are they called? What were those suckers called? Dum-dums. That's not a very nice name, is it? No, we don't call each other dum-dums. But sometimes we treat each other not so nice. Is that how God tells us to treat others? Love. That's right. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, and your mind. But today, I want to read John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. Abby, would you read it for me? That part that's highlighted right there.
I give you a new command. Love one another just as I have loved you. You are also to love... Oh, I already read that. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another.
Well, Jesus said to love one another a whole bunch of times. You think that's important? Absolutely. And Pastor B is going to talk about in Scripture where it says to love your neighbor. Does that mean only the people next door?
No.
Everybody, even the people in your house. Sometimes the people in your house, we have a harder time, brother, sister, even mom. Sometimes we have a hard time loving the people in our house more so than the people next door. But we have to remember, and that's even in our church house, we have to remember that we are to love each other here at church also, right? We're called to do that. Okay, let's pray, and I want you to see if you can come up with a way to love your neighbor this week, okay? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for bringing the kids here to church so that they can hear your word. Help us to have our ears open, our hearts open, so that we hear a message from you. I ask that you bless each one as they are, most of them are on spring break this week. Keep them safe. Help us to have a great week. In your precious and holy name we pray. Amen.
Soul imploring turn to Calvary. Good morning, church family. Let's pray. Good morning, Heavenly Father. Thank you for this beautiful day. Father God, your word says that you own the cattle on 1,000 hills and that every good and perfect gift comes from you. So this morning, we acknowledge that the gifts we have are yours. And we thank you for the privilege of being good stewards of them. Father, this morning as we give from our hearts, bless these thy gifts in order to further your kingdom. Father, help us not only to give from our pocketbooks and wallets, but also from our time and from our talents. We ask that you would use these things as we seek to share your love with those that don't know your son. It's in his name that we pray, amen.
Thank you. Will you please stand with us as we continue to worship this morning?
Where your love ran red and my sin was. Jesus. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in.
Pray with me if you would. Lord Jesus, we do truly owe all to you. It's easy for us to take for granted what you have done, but Lord, today we ask that you would remind us. May we come face to face with the fact that apart from you, we are not worthy of a relationship with you. Apart from your grace, apart from your sacrifice, apart from what you have done for us, we are lost with no hope. But because of the cross and because of the empty tomb, you've made a way. And so we give you praise. We owe everything to you. Remind us today of what you expect for us and from us. Be glorified today. Be glorified in all that we do. Lord Jesus, it's in your name that we pray these things. Amen. Well, the brothers and sisters in the Dominican Republic say thank you. Gracias a Dios y gracias a usted. Thank you for your willingness to support the pastors and their wives in the Dominican Republic. It was one of the best retreats. I say that probably every time I come back from a retreat that we offer to pastors and their wives, but this is the first time that any of them had ever experienced anything like this. And so there were 20 pastors and their wives that got to have a couple of days to refocus, to focus on their own spiritual development, but also on their marriages. And so thank you for your support in that. Thank you for allowing me to be a part of this ministry and to be away occasionally for that. It was truly a blessing. And I'm grateful to Tim Williams for being here last week with you, and the ministry that he has with Stitch and all that he does there. So we are in the midst, we find ourselves in the middle of a season which is somewhat unfamiliar to us as Baptists, as we've talked about over the last few weeks, but the season of Lent, the season that we set aside, the 40 days leading up to Easter. And the purpose, as we've talked about this, is not so much to give something up. I mean, that's typically the question that we ask, right? What are you giving up for Lent, right? But the idea here, the reason that I bring it out, the reason that every year I make a point to talk about this, is it's not so much about what we give up, it's about how we refocus. What have we put into our lives that take the place of what Jesus wants to do in us? The place that Jesus wants in us. What have we put into our lives to dilute that focus? And sometimes, as we've talked about over the last few weeks, sometimes it's good things. Sometimes it's filling our calendar with good things. But if we aren't taking time for what is best, the rest of it doesn't matter. Jesus said, seek what? The kingdom first. And his righteousness. And all these other things will be added. We need to seek him first. And that's really what this season is about. We should be doing this every day. But sometimes we need a reminder, don't we? Sometimes we need a special emphasis during the year to remind us of the importance. And that's really what this season is about. There's always this need, as we began this series or this season, there's a need for us to look back at where we have been, to know where we've come from, in order to truly appreciate what he has done for us. We need to remember that we are lost without him. We need to remember, as we shared in the first sermon with this season, that Paul says, "Oh, wretched man that I am." We need to remember, and it's not comfortable, I get it, I understand, especially in our world where we're told that we're the most important thing, that our happiness matters more than anything else. Look out for ourselves, do unto others before they have a chance to do unto you. All of those things that our world would teach, it bows up against the idea that we are in desperate need. Apart from him, we are lost, without hope. And we need to remember that. And so part of this season is remembering our need for him. We need to remember that without him, we are completely lost. We are desperate. The problem is, if we focus too much on introspection, even in doing that for his glory, even in doing that to try to refresh our relationship with him, if we're not careful, it can become about us. I know when I first started my doctoral work and focusing on spiritual formation and what it takes to grow spiritually, what I had to combat initially were people saying, well, it's just a bunch of navel gazing. Now, for those of you who don't know that term, it's just sitting and just looking in, not really focusing on outward. But here's what we need to remember. The idea of focusing on our own spiritual health, the idea of transformation, of becoming more like Jesus, is primarily not about us. It's not about feeling better about ourselves. It's not about something that we get from this. In fact, if focusing on our own spiritual well-being becomes more about what we get out of it, it is less about honoring Jesus. The primary reason to become more like Jesus every day is so that we can live like he did and love like he does. That's why we need to become more like Jesus. It's not for what we get out of it, although I will tell you, following him is a life of peace, a life of joy, a life of hope. And we've talked about my definitions of those words before, so I won't bore you again with that. But that's what the life that he gives us. But it's not about that. Our transformation, our following Jesus, is so that we can live like he did and love like he does. How are we doing on that? That's what this season really should be about, is looking at how we are truly following him. Or are we? You see, we as believers were saved from sin, saved from death. When Jesus went to that cross, he paid my price. He paid your price for your sin, for my sin. He paid for it. But if he stayed on that cross, there would be no hope for us. He went into a grave, and what happened 3 days later? He rose. In a couple weeks, a few weeks, we're going to celebrate that. But just as a reminder, as I say every year, and I've said it already this year, don't rush to the empty tomb and fail to pause at the cross. But you see, it takes both. He paid the price for our sin to save us from death, to save us from our own sin. And he rose again to save us to a life lived for him. So we are saved from our sin, from death, but we are saved for a purpose. To serve him, to live our lives for him. And so today what I want us to start thinking about in regards to the season, but even more so just in how we are to live our lives, is that we are saved from sin and death and saved to a life lived for him. What does that look like? It doesn't look like sitting in a closet all day long thinking about our own spiritual health. I believe we're supposed to sit and be with Jesus for sure. But the purpose of that is so that we can see out and see the need and meet the need. Jesus was asked, in fact, the Luke account, which we'll read in just a moment, says that it was a teacher, a leader that was trying to test Jesus. And so he went to Jesus and he said, what's the greatest of all the commandments? What's the greatest? Let me just read it. Luke chapter 10, beginning in verse 25. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What is written in the law? He replied, how do you read it? The man answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly, Jesus replied, do this and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Who's my neighbor? In reply, Jesus said, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he fell into the hands of robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, took him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. the Markan account, the account we find in Mark, is Jesus says, this is the greatest commandment. To love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. And the second is like it, he says, love your neighbor as yourself. If these are the greatest commandments, don't you think we ought to look into these a little deeper? Don't you think that we ought to truly understand the importance? If Jesus would say this is the greatest commandment. Why does it matter that we love our neighbors? Ginger shared with the children just a moment ago the passage in John that says that we are to love. And that it is by our love that what? People will know that we follow him, that we are his disciples. We are to be a people of love. This is so important for us to understand because it's easy for us to just look the other way. It's easy for us to walk by on the other side of the road. But we are to love. It's not surprising that the greatest command is that we love the Lord our God with all that we have, all that we are. But think about the significance. Jesus says, the second is like it, we are to what? Love our neighbors as ourselves. I think it's pretty important. We should have to wrestle with that. That we are to love God, but we are to love one another. He puts those side by side. That we are to be a people of love who love other people, our neighbors. This is the greatest command. 1 John chapter 4, verse 20, it says, you say you love God, but if you don't love your neighbor, what? You're a liar. That's pretty powerful language. Now, we could say John was older in his life, and I've always heard that once you hit 70 or 80, that you can say whatever you want, and it's okay. I'm getting closer. By the way, I don't find that in Scripture, so maybe John's getting a little older in his age, but he says, if you say you love God, but you don't love your neighbor, you're a liar. That should cause us to pause. Really, another way to interpret that, to look at that, is the level that you love God is reflected in the level that you love others. Think about that for a minute. We say we love God, but do we love our neighbors? This is extremely important. It's not a suggestion. It's a vital part of what it means to follow Jesus. It's central. It's not on the periphery. This is central to who we are as believers. If we say we are disciples of Jesus, then we need to show his love. Jesus commands you to love your neighbors. That's part of following him. So who is our neighbor? What is the picture of a neighbor in this story? Who's the neighbor in the story? The Samaritan, the one who showed mercy. Jesus was intentional in naming this merciful person as a Samaritan. He was trying to get their attention. We've talked about this before, and I know you probably know this, but for the Jewish religion, for the Jewish mindset, there were other people who were fellow Jews, those were your neighbors. And Jesus knew this. Jesus knew this because, not to just totally burst your bubble, but Jesus was Jewish. So Jesus knew this, that this was the mindset, that a neighbor is a fellow Jew and everybody else is outcast. No one else fits this bill. And so Jesus intentionally telling this story picked not only a Samaritan, the worst of the worst, the half-breeds, the ones that we don't talk to, the ones that if we even walk through their country, we have to go through purification rites, those people. He intentionally chose a Samaritan, and if that weren't bad enough, who did he throw under the bus? A priest and a Levite. You think that didn't get their attention? I thought about making this kind of current to our world today, but you can imagine. Jesus got their attention. A man was going down from Jerusalem, and he was robbed and beaten and left for dead. And two different religious leaders walked by on the other side, didn't want to get involved. And then a person who, from a Jewish mindset, was the worst of the worst, actually stopped and had mercy and helped. Jesus is making a point about who neighbors are. Who are the good neighbors? In fact, maybe the story shouldn't be the Good Samaritan, but the good neighbor. So who is your neighbor? The Greek word here for neighbor literally means one who is near. It doesn't mean one who shares your beliefs. It doesn't mean one who looks like you. It means one who is near. So neighbors aren't just people who look like you. Neighbors aren't just people you like. Neighbors are those who are near. The one right in front of you, regardless of race, regardless of socioeconomic background, regardless of the differences, he calls us to love our neighbors as ourselves. And our neighbors are whoever he puts in our path, those near us, those around us, the people around you each day. The question I have for me and for you is, do you see them? Do you see them? Do you care? If your neighbor is anyone near you, anyone in your sphere of influence, Jesus commands us to love, to care. Ginger's already pointed this out with the children, but maybe it starts in your home. Those within your own home. Maybe your neighbor is the person on your street or the person you work with or go to school with. The person you see at the grocery store, even the person who cuts you off in traffic. I got personal there, didn't I? If you're ever following me, sometimes I'm not a good neighbor when I drive, I'm just going to say. Jesus says, love your neighbor as yourself. And he illustrates that teaching by telling us that our neighbors are those right in front of us, those around us, those in our city. In the story that Jesus used to illustrate this idea, the man was in desperate need of help. He was beaten and robbed and left for dead. There are people right here in this city who have physical needs. And we need to be doing our best to show Jesus love and trying to meet those needs. And we do have some ministries that do that. Our street ministry, our food pantry, other things that we do throughout the week that try to meet those needs. Our partnerships with different ministries in town and in our area. But I want to look past that. How many people in our community need Jesus? Do we see them? Do we care that they need Jesus? What are we doing to reach them, to share the love of Christ with them? Your neighbor is whoever God puts in your path. The Jewish leaders were on their way to serve, and they came across a person who truly needed them, but they made excuses. Now, we're not told in the story, but given their position, we can make a safe assumption that they were on their way about doing what, in their minds, God wanted them to do. They were being faithful priests and Levites. They were leaders. They couldn't be bothered with this. They had so many other more important things to do. In fact, in the Jewish religious system, if they touched someone who was injured, they could be considered unclean and have to go through all kinds of ritual purification in order just to serve again. So I'm not making excuses or defense for them, but that's what was probably going on in their minds in this story. What excuses do we make? It's easy, isn't it? I talked to a friend recently who had spent some time in New York City. And they said one of the things that was most profound was how the residents there just stopped seeing the need. Passing people that were in need. I think we see that here. Are we sensitive to the people around us, or do we make excuses? It's just easier to not see. It's easier to not think about. But Jesus commands us to think about it. He commands us to love our neighbors. Are we prepared? I got a text Friday or yesterday, I don't remember which, from a church member who found out through choir rehearsal that the subject of today's sermon would be the Good Samaritan story, and they sent me a picture of their doormat. The doormat says, "Mitchell Rogers did not adequately prepare me for the people in my neighborhood." I'm sure that is true. And if we're looking to Mr. Rogers to teach us how to do this, we're looking in the wrong place anyway. But you get the point. Sometimes we can make excuses. Sometimes our neighbors are not pleasant people. Don't look around. Some of us may say, "I don't know anyone I would call a neighbor." Or, "I just don't want to get involved." Or, "I have more important things to do." In one of my devotions recently, they used the New Living Translation for Galatians 6:3. And in the New Living Translation, it says, "If you think you're too important to help someone, you are only fooling yourself. You are not that important." That kind of convicted me. So we do make excuses, but here's one that I pray we will never make. Do we really want those people in our church? If we're to love our neighbors, if we are to be welcoming, sharing Jesus with those who need Jesus, we can't make these kind of excuses. Loving our neighbor isn't a choice. We are commanded to do this. And to kind of circle back, when we consider where we would be if Jesus did not love us, we should be inspired to love Him and love others. When we think about where we would be without Him, without His love for us, we ought to be inspired to follow Him and to love others, to do what He says. As I said earlier, this isn't a suggestion. This is central to following Jesus, loving Him and loving others, loving our neighbors. So when it comes to following what Jesus commands, you do not have an excuse. Nor do I. We don't have an excuse for not following Him. Next week, we're going to look at how we can care for our neighbors. But I want to give you some things to be thinking about or working on this week. Begin this week being sensitive. Actually look. Think about the people around you. Do they know Jesus? Who are the people in your path that need him, that you see every day? And think about, who is Jesus calling you to love? Who is Jesus calling you to love? Next week, as I said, I'll have some ideas on how we do this, some practical ideas on showing his love. But be focused this week on seeing those people, asking Jesus to point out those people that he wants you to love. So my challenge for us as we close is, Jesus has commanded you to love God and love others. Commit to doing that with all you have every day. Where would we be without Jesus? May that spark inspiration to truly follow him today. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your love. I thank you for your sacrifice for me and for us, for all people. You don't desire anyone to die without a relationship with you. You came to bring forgiveness and salvation, but you don't force that on us. And so you use us to love, to show others what it means to live a life of service to you, of surrender to you. Help us to do that well this week. Help us to love well. Open our eyes to those around us that you are calling us to love. Spark us to have moments in conversation, moments in discipleship, moments in inviting. We thank you for what you have done for us, the love that you have for us, the grace that you show to us. May that inspire us this week, Jesus, to do what you called us to do, what you've commanded us to do. Find us faithful. It's in your name we pray it. Amen. Just a moment, I'll ask you to stand for a time of response. God is at work. Amen. God is at work. The greatest thing we can do is find out where and join him there. And so may we be about that this week. If there's a decision that you would like to make, this is the time in the service to do that. If you'd like prayer, Ginger will be here, John will be here, I'll be here. We invite you to come and we'll pray with you. But more than anything, during this time, truly focus on what he has commanded us to do. To love God with all that we have, all that we are, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. Think on that as we stand and sing together.
Here am I, send me. Here am I, Lord, send me. Unto thee willingly, yielded I come. Show the path that I must walk. Compel me then to go, and if I stray, bring back the light of day. For here am I, send me, I pray. Here am I, send me. Here am I, Lord, send me. Precious Holy Spirit, come, fill me anew. Give me wisdom, send me strength, grant that I may be a mirror of your never-ending love. For here am I, send me, I. take my heart, it is your own. My will is thine. Take my voice and let me sing always unto thee, so that my days shall flow in ceaseless praise. Lord, here am I, send me, I pray. Here am I, send me. Here am I, Lord, send me. Unto thee willingly, yielded I come. Show the path that I must walk. Compel me then to go, and if I stray, bring back the light of day, for here am I, send me, I pray.
You can have a seat. It is the kickoff of spring break for a lot of families, so we will not have Sunday night services, no Sunday night classes tonight, but next Sunday night we will have a church conference, so mark your calendars. I know you won't want to miss it. So, but please join us next Sunday night for discipleship. If you have not been, we would love to plug you in and get you connected. And Chris has a sign up for volunteers for a Rise and Run. Easter events are coming around. We're only a few weeks away. So if you don't want to walk, don't want to run, you want to hand out water, you want to work registration tables, Chris has some volunteer spots that are available for that, and he's got a sign up out in the hallway. That same morning, Saturday before Easter, I will have a Journey to the Cross event. It is a walkthrough experience for families, for kids and their parents, to go through the different experiences that Jesus had before Easter Sunday or before the resurrection, and to celebrate that. So I would encourage you to bring your families to enjoy that together, to help the kids understand a little bit more of the importance of Easter. April 7th, we have Modern Service launching off. We would love to have you join us or pray for us. You know, if you're going to be staying here in the blended service, that's great. But please be praying for that transition and mark your times, because the times will change for that worship service hour. So we are glad you're here this morning. Pastor B.
We are glad that you're here today. I saw a meme this morning on Facebook. It said today the old hymn, "How Great Thou Art," will be changed to "How Late Thou Art." And I'm really glad that you are here. It's a blessing. It's a blessing to be together. Do, as Ginger said, pray for the launch of the Modern Service. That will be coming after Easter. But between now and then, again, don't rush to the empty tomb. We will celebrate for sure. But don't rush to the empty tomb without first stopping at the foot of the cross, because without that cross, there would be no empty tomb. So as we are dismissed today, be reminded that apart from Him, we can do nothing. May the God who loves us so much that He sent His one and only Son to die for us remind us today that we are to live for Him by loving well. Amen. We're dismissed.
Okay.